If I say the word mummy, I bet you picture ancient Egypt and a body wrapped in white linen, maybe fighting Brendan Fraser or a terrible CGI version of The Rock. But while Egypt has undeniably earned its spot in our collective minds as the mummy place, mummifying the dead was a practice in many different cultures throughout history. And those places had some very different methods for doing it. So let's pry open the coffin of history and have a look. From Alaska to the Philippines, here are the many ways that people made their mummies. First, let's talk about how you make a mummy. Because while mummification has often been an intensive, purposeful choice, turns out that people don't need to be involved at all. Cases of accidental mummification happen all around the world, at least where the conditions are right. So what are the right conditions? Looking at a few examples can clue us in, and we may as well start with Egypt. Dating to somewhere between 3300 and 3000 BCE, a group of bodies known as the Gebelein mummies weren't mummified on purpose. When you look at them, you don't see the complex embalming or linen wrapping you probably associate with ancient Egyptian burial practices. Instead, it was simply the fact that they were buried in shallow graves out in the hot, very dry desert that did the trick. They're so well preserved that we can still see their tattoos with infrared light. We can even tell that at least one of them was murdered, stabbed in the back. For a second example, let's stay around the same time as the Gebelein mummies, but travel north to the Alps. That's where we'll find another natural mummy with tattoos, and who also seems to have been murdered, Otzi the Iceman. What do these two sites have in common? Both the desert and the freezing mountain conditions got rid of the liquid water. And when there's no water, the microbes and other decomposers that'd normally break down a body can't grow. And that's key to making a mummy. As another example, scientists have found accidental mummies in Iranian salt mines. The salt sucked all the water out of them. Salt also has the additional benefit of having antimicrobial chloride ions. After all, think about why we put chlorine in our pools. With enough chemicals, you don't even need to remove the water. Bog bodies like the Harald Skjær woman in Denmark are evidence of that fact. These were preserved due to the super acidic, oxygen-poor, microbe-destroying bog water they were dunked in. Ultimately, making a mummy is all about driving off the decomposing bacteria, fungi, and other microbes that normally break down bodies after death. If you're able to do that, mummification can happen accidentally, even in otherwise normal burials. Back in the Joseon period in Korea, which lasted all the way from the late 14th century to the early 20th, coffins would be encased with a mixture of ingredients that would release a bunch of heat as they hardened, much like concrete does. So not only did these coffins become hermetically sealed, depriving bacteria of oxygen, those microbes could have also been roasted to death. Similar things have happened inside funerary vaults called columbaria in Guanajuato, Mexico, as well as crypts in Vats, Hungary. But sometimes humans look to create these conditions on purpose. So now let's get to intentional mummification. A couple quick disclaimers though before we really jump in. A lot of cultures have done at least a bit of mummification over the years, so this is not an exhaustive list. We also, unfortunately, don't have time to go super in-depth on the culture or the religious aspects of mummification. What mummies can tell us about how humans think about legacy or our relationship with the past generations or how we process emotions like grief is really interesting, but this episode is more of how to make a mummy and not why you make a mummy. That said, if something I mentioned sparks any interest, do take this as a jumping off point to learn more on your own. With those caveats out of the way, let's start with the oldest known intentional mummies. And no, it's not the Egyptians. Instead, we need to go to the dry Atacama coast of South America, along southern Peru and northern Chile, roughly 7,000 years ago. Here, a group of people called the Chinchorro lived in small, sedentary groups. They got their food from a couple of different places, but really specialized in fishing. And beginning as far back as 5050 BCE, they started purposely mummifying their dead. And they did it in an interesting way that evolved over time too. After their skin and organs were removed, the body was stuffed with material like earth and sticks. And then the skin was usually put back, especially on the face, and that skin was covered in black paint. Scholars called this the black style, and this was their practice for around 2,500 years. Then, from around 2,500 to 2000 BCE, another style called the red style came into fashion. In this case, the body was largely kept intact and organs removed via incisions in the abdomen and shoulders. Also, as the name might suggest, the body paint switched from black to red, although the paint on the face remained black. They're visually striking, but another interesting note about Chinchorro's mummies is it seems that everyone got mummified in the red and black periods, not just the elite or the upper classes like in other societies. Finally, there was the mud coat period, which may have overlapped with the red style, going from about 2100 to 1700 BCE. In this case, the bodies may have been largely kept intact, smoke-dried, and then covered in mud and paint. Overall, the people there seemed to practice mummification for more than 3,000 years, which is an incredible amount of time, giving a run for the money to the world's most famous mummy makers. Speaking of which, let's talk about Egypt. The earliest known intentional Egyptian mummy may be the Turin mummy. This person lived around the same time as the Gebelin mummies, about 3,500 BCE, and he was first thought to be another accidental nature mummy. But a closer look starting in 2014 revealed he'd been treated with an embalming salve not too dissimilar to what was used during Egypt's mummification heyday, 2,500 years later. This suggests that Egyptians were starting to mummify their dead long, long before its peak. That said, he was still pretty different from what you might think of as a typical Egyptian mummy, because he was found in a fetal position with all his organs. As for how it worked during that heyday, according to Greek historians like Herodotus, there were a few different techniques over time, and based on the individual status, but the best option seems to have started with cutting the body open to disembowel it. The important organs, like liver and lungs, were removed and put in jars. The brain would be removed and discarded, but the heart, the most important organ, was left inside. They'd then properly wash and coat the body cavity with palm wine and spices. Linen and other material would then be used to fill out and eventually wrap the body. Meanwhile, the middle option, the economy package, you might say, would have been a bit less involved. Instead of careful removal, a mortician may have injected cedar oil into the gut to dissolve the internal organs, and then let the liquid leak out the rectum. Finally, the cheapest option may have been to simply clear the intestines with an enema, with no other organ removal. Some academics have questioned exactly how representative this menu really is, particularly the cheaper options. But remember, we're talking about something that was practiced for thousands of years, so some variation is to be expected. No matter what option the deceased went with, though, the next step after dealing with the internal organs always seems to have been using natron, a natural compound that's a mix of different sodium salts, for drying out the body. The people who paid for the expensive option would be wrapped in linen, resin, and other accessories, your classic mummy, while others may have just been returned to their families after drying. While the Egyptian tradition may have started after the Chinchorro, it too lasted for thousands of years, even into the Roman period, which started at 30 BCE, although the practice would eventually peter out after that. But maybe we should include a late addenda to that, because in 2011, the body of a British taxi driver named Alan Billis was mummified according to ancient Egyptian tradition. This was a scientific endeavor to better understand the compounds used and the chemistry behind the Egyptian process. Billis had volunteered for the procedure after learning that he had terminal lung cancer. But he wasn't the first European to be mummified, and not even the first after the Egyptians. But before we get into another example, first, an ad.
Thanks to ACT for supporting this SciShow video. Not just the popular college admissions test you're familiar with, but their new enhanced ACT that's shorter and still accepted by all colleges. The enhanced ACT is designed to reduce pressure, give you more control, and support your college goals. Plus, the ACT is the only test that allows you to purchase your own question and answer key 3 times a year. The upcoming October test is your first opportunity to learn, improve, and do better the next time you test. Another way you can go into the test calmer is by preparing with their real ACT questions that are available at quizme.act.org before you take the official test. You can learn more about the ACT or register for the next upcoming test by scanning the QR code or by clicking the link in the description.
For our third example, let's talk about one unusual case from Austria. In this case, we're talking about a single mummy who seems to have lived in the mid-1700s. They were likely a local aristocratic vicar during their life. Finding a mummy in Austria is unusual, and the corpse's unique preservation had originally been chalked up to some unknown accidental factor in the crypt. But in 2025, a new examination revealed that this may have been purposeful. Scientists found that the body had, in fact, been prepared using a never-before-seen embalming method. The internal organs were not removed. Instead, quite a lot of wood chips, twigs, fabric, and a mostly zinc chloride solution were inserted into the body via the rectum. And even though the internal organs were still there, this mixture seems to have done the job of keeping any microbes from growing. As to why the vicar was preserved this way, we don't know. It's unusual, but the researchers speculate that the people who did this may have intended to bury the vicar at his original home abbey, in which case the body stuffing and zinc preparation may have been an attempt to make sure his body didn't rot during transportation. And even though he didn't end up making that trip, the preservation worked. Maybe a lot better than expected. We don't know whether the vicar had intended to be preserved after his death, but in this next example, the people in question very much did. In fact, they kind of took it upon themselves to do it. For our fourth example, let's go to Japan, where a number of Buddhist monks did what's known as sokushin butsu, self-mummification. So far, the ways that people have been mummified have had some strong parallels, particularly the removal of internal organs. But the next few examples highlight some more novel processes. In the case of some Buddhist monks in Asia, particularly in Japan, the process would actually start long before the person died. The monk in question would start the process by switching from their normal diet to a highly restricted one, which seems to have mostly consisted of pine needles, resins, and seeds. This combination would cause severe dehydration and near starvation, eliminating pretty much all the fat from their bodies. As the time of death drew closer, they would cease eating and drinking altogether, spending their time meditating, retreating from everyone, and being sealed away in a box to await death. Their bodies, with so little water and fat content left, and sealed away from the elements, would naturally resist decay even without further treatment, although additional drying did occur. The earliest confirmed sokushin butsu date back to at least the 1300s CE, but records suggest the practice dates back to the 800s. The practice was never widespread, though, and seems to have largely ended during the Meiji Restoration in the late 1800s. Next, let's go to the north, to the Aleutian Islands, off the coast of mainland Alaska. A foggy, rain-beaten island in the Arctic might seem like a strange place to find a mummy, but according to reports from the 1800s and 1900s, one community there seems to have been practicing mummification for centuries. Bodies were prepared by removing their internal organs and fatty tissues through an incision in the abdomen, and then stuffed with dry grass. The body was then put in running water to remove the last of the fat, and then carefully air-dried. After that, they were clothed, wrapped in waterproof animal skins and intestines. So far, this seems to resemble some of the earlier forms of mummification we've highlighted, but the way the mummies were then dried out relies on a particular geological quirk of this area. The key to achieving mummification in such a weather-beaten place seems to have been the existence of a cave, heated and kept dry by volcanic vents. After preparation, the bodies were put into this warm, dry cave and kept off the ground on platforms or suspended from the ceiling. This way, no matter what weather the North Pacific had in store, the mummies were kept safe and dry, allowing them to be preserved for a very long time. Heat is also a key feature in our last example, the so-called fire mummies. These were found in the rugged, mountainous municipality of Cabayan in the Philippines, and mainly practiced by an indigenous group called the Ibaloy. In this case, the process might have started with a salty brine put in the mouth after or possibly even right before death. Either way, the dead body was then washed in cold water, dressed in a blanket and headscarf, and secured to a chair. Fluids were allowed to drain, and then the chair was tied to a ladder and a low, smoky fire built underneath it. Rather than natron or salt or anything like that, it was the smoke that helped dry out and preserve the body, a process that may have taken months. Time in the sun and plant juices may have also been used in the process to help things along. But once that was done, the skin was removed, the body dressed in funerary blankets, and then taken to a cave for entombment. The practice was definitely happening through the 1700s to the 1900s, but possibly hundreds of years earlier. It's a bit hard to pin down exactly because we have no written sources, just oral tradition. And other places may have practiced something similar as well. Smoking, or sun drying, was also a practice in Australia, New Guinea, and the Torres Strait Islands. To sum up, lots of different cultures have practiced mummification and have used a variety of different techniques. It all comes down to preventing rot, usually through finding a way to dry the body out, though preservative chemicals are also often important. Which leads us to a final bonus example, because humanity is still developing ways to make mummies. For example, there's plastination, which uses chemicals to replace the water and fat in body tissue with polymers like epoxy or silicone. It's perhaps most famously viewable in the Body Worlds exhibit, which contains whole bodies. But plastinated body parts are found as museum pieces and as anatomical models for med students to study. So yeah, while the word mummy might conjure up pictures of the Nile and pyramids, this practice has been common throughout history, right up to the present day.